Welcome to Career and Life Chats with Andrea, where I chat with lawyers about their careers and what makes a meaningful life. My guest today is my friend June Cheng, an immigration attorney. Originally from China, June moved to the US for law school, graduating from the University of Minnesota in 2010. She now works at the law firm of Fredrickson and Byron in Minneapolis, helping foreign investors, entrepreneurs, and Chinese and American companies retain talent and achieve global mobility. When I think of June, the words resilient, kind-hearted, and joyful come to mind. She's overcome tough moments that would cripple many, finding her unique way to hold life lightly with wisdom and grace. Thank you for joining me today, June.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, and congratulations on baby number 3 on the way. How exciting for you.
Thank you. Yeah. I just hope that she stays in there until due date. So let me finish all the things on my to-do list before I have to go.
Yeah, well, it's very soon. So hopefully, I don't know, we'll see if she arrives during this chat.
Stop it. <She'll come out. laughs>
Very good. Well, I thought we would get started by talking about your career as a lawyer. It's been 10 years, a whole decade. And I wonder, when you look back on those 10 years, are there any patterns or themes that stand out for you?
That's a good question. You know, let me give you a little background of what I went through. And I graduated in 2010. Well, we both did. And I was right in the middle of a recession. And, you know, everyone was struggling. Most of us were struggling to find a job. And as a foreign student at the time, it was especially difficult because my ability to stay in this country is tied to having a job that can sponsor me for my status in the US. So I worked as a intern at a nonprofit for a while. I worked as a litigator at a very small law firm for a few months. And then this incredible opportunity came up to join Fredrickson as an immigration lawyer, came to me. And I jumped on it. It was not something that I planned when I was in law school, but it just happened to be the passion of my life that I didn't know about until then. And 9 years later, I'm still here.
Yeah, I think it's so moving because you yourself as an immigrant to be practicing in an area of law that is so directly relevant in your own life and to be able to give that back to others who are in similar situations, I imagine must be very meaningful.
It is. It's very meaningful. And you know, this type of work is rewarding to me both on a personal level because of my own experience as an immigrant, but also just working with people who are trying so hard to and who work their or their butt off. I don't know if that's okay to say on YouTube. Really working so hard to try to make a living, try to realize a dream, and being able to be a part of their journey is really heartwarming and very rewarding. And every time we get an email from a client saying, oh, thank you so much for getting me the visa, getting me the green card, this has changed our family's life, that just fuels what we do.
Right, making a very real impact in everyday people's lives. Yeah, well, so you had mentioned you had worked briefly for a couple months at a smaller law firm. Were you doing immigration work at that time?
No, so when I was in law school, I had this idea that I want to be a litigator. And at the time it was partly because I thought that my language skills would be of service to, you know, the immigrant community in Minnesota who could not speak well, speak English well, but who needs legal representation in the courtroom. And so I went down that path at the beginning and just realized that that's really not what I'm passionate about and not what I am built to do. I think there is something about, you know, the different types of practice within the legal profession. Some require certain personality and others other personalities. So after a few months, I just decided that that's not what I want to do for the rest of my life.
Yeah. And what was it about being a litigator that did not feel like a good fit for you?
For me, well, I think part of it is because of litigation, but more because I was in family litigation. I was doing family law. And unlike immigration, where you're trying to help your client to build a life, for family law practice, you know, it felt to me that I'm tearing people's family apart, even though I know that it's such an important practice area and there are people who really need help in that area to keep their, you know, to move forward with their life. And it's usually when someone ends up in family court, that's such a difficult time in their life. It's just that I couldn't personally handle that kind of situation well and be able to separate my own life from my clients' cases. And that's probably the breaking point for me to say, I probably should look for something else.
Right. And I know how caring of a person you are. So that does not surprise me when you say that. Yeah. Well, June, you also mentioned too, you know, some of the challenges as a foreign student. And I think it's so understandable, especially if you're under that pressure of, oh gosh, in order to stay in the US, I need to find a job. I wonder if you could elaborate a little bit more about some of the challenges you were experiencing, you know, certainly just as a foreigner coming to the US for the first time for a law school and then looking for a job. What were some of the challenges that came up for you?
I think, you know, I'll start with the challenges that any foreign students will face. Regardless of what the current environment is. And that's as a student, you're on a specific type of immigration status, right? You're a student, you get, for law students, after we graduate, we get about 1 year to find some sort of practical training opportunities. And after that 1 year, you have to be able to get a job, well, within that 1 year, really, within the first 6 months, you have to find a job that's willing to sponsor a work visa for you in order for you to continue staying and working in the US. And that's stressful to begin with, because as a foreign student, a lot of law firms are not accustomed to hiring foreign students. There are only very limited opportunities where our background is beneficial, I think, to certain types of positions. And then on top of that, the employers have to jump through this hoop to try to qualify the candidate for a certain type of visa. And that, I'm talking about H-1B visa for professional or skilled workers. And that type of visa traditionally has been very difficult to get, not because of the candidate's own eligibility or the position, but because there are way more people who want to apply for it than the number of visas available each year. So, you know, when the economy is good, only a third or half of the people who apply even get to be selected into this random lottery that the government run to have their case being reviewed by the government. So when employer hires a foreign worker, they run the risk of putting all this money and investment into a student, not only for the legal fees, the training, but also, you know, all the resources to bring somebody on board, and then you may lose this person in 6 months. So. You know, for employers and employees, that's a level of stress that you don't have to deal with if you're hiring a U.S. worker. On top of that, in 2010, you know, because of the economy and because of the tough job market, it was just very hard to find anything. Yeah. And I think like that from time to time you see that same kind of situation for foreign workers and for US workers, obviously. So we have to kind of just deal with all the uncertainty, not knowing, do I have a job tomorrow? Do I have a paycheck tomorrow? But also, do I get to still stay here tomorrow?
Right. And, you know, with some of the foreign students and young attorneys that I work with, one common challenge that I hear too is this idea of, you know, you're in a different culture. It's the language is secondary to what you know. And mm-hmm. when it comes to networking, which is a key part of any job search, I know a lot of people feel like they're at a disadvantage because they're not originally from the US. And I wonder, how did you navigate, if that came up for you at all, how did you navigate yes. that?
Yeah, and that's a great point. You know, the cultural differences. I think for, is depending, you know, I can't say generally that all foreign students go through the same thing, right? And every one of us come from a different culture, from different background and country. And some of us may have family members who are in the legal profession and others don't. I personally come from a family where none of my relatives or my parents have any idea of what being a lawyer is, let alone being a lawyer in America. And I think for me, the networking part and that cultural differences part became more obvious as I started to practice. I had no clue when I was in college, when I was in law school, what I was supposed to do in terms of networking. You know, I went to all the events, I collected, you know, hundreds of business cards, and then I don't know what to do with them.
You know? You're like, who are these people?
Right, exactly. And 2 months later, you're like, I don't remember any of them. And also just that expectation of what you're supposed to do in a networking context. And I didn't know that you were supposed to follow up with people. I didn't know that you are supposed to, you know, reach out and schedule coffee breaks and informal informational interviews, that kind of things when I was in law school. And that all came as I grew as a lawyer and as I found my mentors in my practice and see what other friends and, you know, colleagues do in their professional life. But that's something that I think for, it's challenging for foreign students who can't get kind of just airlifted and dropped into this environment without really knowing what the legal profession really is, yeah. is like and how it operates.
Right, and it's so hard to know what you don't know until somebody says, oh, by the way, have you thought about this? Have you thought about
right.
that?
Right.
Right.
You know, I think we see that with even with people who are born here who are from a family background or a cultural background where they are not familiar with the legal profession, right? And you have people who don't really know what acting, you know, what profession, being a professional really means and how people would expect you to behave in a certain way mm-hmm. until someone actually steps up and tell you. And I think that, you know, applies to a lot of foreign students too.
Yeah, no, I love that you brought up the fact that it's not just foreigners who are experiencing this. If you literally don't have lawyers in your family, you know, before you, how are you supposed mm-hmm. to know?
Yeah. Right.
Well, what advice do you have for somebody who doesn't have that long lineage of lawyers in their family? What advice would you have for them in terms of building up their network, you know, looking for new opportunities if they're looking to transition?
Mm-hmm. I think the one advice that I got when I was, I think this was when I was just graduated from law school and was starting to really aggressively looking for a job and trying to, you know, network in the community. One of my professors at the time who I'm so grateful for for helping me out, she basically told me that networking is really not just going out and attending events and collecting business cards. Networking is a long-term investment where you're really supposed to be building relationship with people in the community. And And that had benefited me so much to really change my view of what networking really is. And it's, you know, I try to, when I meet somebody who may share a certain, you know, common interest with me, I find their practice interesting, I try to stay in touch. I try to view networking as making friends within the community. And really that's how I got my job now. So the Laura Danielson, she was the head of our immigration department at Fredrickson. She was also my professor in law school, and I took her immigration law class, I think in 2L year. And I just kept in touch with her after the class, and I sometimes would send her articles that I found interesting and ask her about her opinion about it. And at the time, I didn't really register it as networking. I just thought that, oh, this is a really interesting and fascinating person, and she has this all these interesting ideas that I just want to pick her brain on. But later on, when she started telling me, oh, I'm starting to build this practice within our group that's China facing, we would love to have someone who has the language ability and the cultural background. And I was there when the opening finally was made, and I just grabbed onto the opportunity. But later on, she told me that she was impressed, and she thought of me as a good candidate for the job because of all the follow-ups and all the touch the context that I have maintained with her, which I didn't know when I did it. Now that's like the advice that I give to all the students, because I think that's something that we didn't really know. And that's different from the kind of networking that we were told to do. So yeah, that's my experience.
Yeah, and I think you raised such a good point there, June. I mean, when you were networking with your then to, you know, down the road employer, it was genuine. I mean, you were so, it wasn't like you were trying to weasel your way into a job at that time. You were literally just keeping in touch with your professor, right, keeping her updated, sharing something that might be useful to her. And so kind of my takeaway from, you know, your description right there is, one, be genuine about it, because I think people sense when a person's being inauthentic in building a relationship. Nobody wants to feel used. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of that too, the second point really was, you were just consistent, right, and following up repeatedly, but not enough, like, don't be annoying about it, because you can also, one can also take that to the extreme and just become really irritating to somebody. So really keep it genuine. And it can pay off in spades, as it did for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I'm wondering, you know, for anybody who's interested out there in getting into the immigration world, what advice do you have for them? What should they know about the field? And I know that's a very broad question.
I don't know if I'm doing a good job, advertising our practice area, just because right now the immigration field is such a stressful field because of the greater environment that we operate within. But I think for anyone who is interested in immigration, obviously take the immigration law class if you have access to. It's a very complicated, highly regulated area of law. A lot of the work that we do, well, there are litigators, and there are also more, we can't really say that it's contractual work, because it's more administrative, right? Because we deal mostly with the government. So it's really important to understand the different agencies, the history of immigration law. That's something that I didn't appreciate when I was in law school, when I took the class, the history of immigration and immigration regulations in the US. But as we practice, I realize how important it is to understand that history, because not everything makes sense if you just look at them in their current you know, shape and form until you understand, oh, this layer was added in the 1940s and this layer was added in the 1990s. And the things that govern how we do things today were put into place 30 years ago. So, you know, like one of the things that we do when we try to get a lot of skilled workers a green card is that the employer has to make a recruitment for the position. They have to test the labor market. Right? By testing, you have to post job postings. You have to do certain types of, specifically certain types of recruitment effort. And one of them is posting the job on a Sunday newspaper ad on two consecutive Sundays. The first thing that a lot of our clients say is that who posts job ads on Sunday newspapers anymore? Nobody look at Sunday newspapers. that's the regulation that was put in place 30 years ago that says you need to do it. And nobody has gone in and changed it. So that's what we have to do. So understanding the history is really important. And I think for immigration, one thing that's very special about us, not saying that none of the other legal practices would share this kind of characteristic, but I do find immigration law to be very personal, you get to make this connection with our clients who, you know, we know their date of marriage, we know their birthdays, we know how many kids they have, where they had their kids. as they move along in their career, we know that every step that they've made, because every time they change their position, we have to file an amendment. So we follow through on people's life, and, you know, over years, sometimes decades, and you build this really long lasting relationship with the clients that I find really rewarding.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but you know, at the same time, it also means that we deal with our clients' stress a lot, especially now, because everyone's so nervous about their status, nervous about the uncertainty of their future, particularly because, you know, probably in the past year, but also in the past 4 years, there has been a lot of policy changes and legislative changes that made it more difficult for people to maintain their status. And people are freaking out.
Yeah.
So that level of stress is also personal to us, right, as lawyers.
How do you manage that stress?
It's a good question. I think you have to apply your own. Everyone has a different way of dealing with it. You know, we have colleagues who are so fired up, and their traditional practice may be more on the affirmative application side, and now they're transitioning into being a litigator. There are definitely more federal lawsuits brought by applicants, by employers, and their lawyers to challenge wrong government rulings. And there are people who, you know, we also need to up our empathy game to really understand what our clients are going through and understand that their stress and the aggression, or not the frustration that they present sometimes is not to us personally, but a manifestation of where they are in their life, right? And being able to separate that is important, and also have a good balance in our own life, which is hard to do, I know, for a lot of people when we're also dealing with the pandemic. Yeah, so I think it's a challenge for everybody, but I try to keep my eyes on the outcome and on what we're really ultimately trying to achieve, and you know, try to remind myself that in the end, this is going to work out.
Yeah, and I think one of the things I've so admired about you, June, over these years is your ability to keep your perspective so broad and for the long term. You really have always had that ability to see things from, you know, the bird's eye view, which I think really has served you in many different contexts. And I thought we'd shift gears a little bit and talk about you, June. You are not only an attorney, you're also a wife, you're a mother, in addition to just June, your own person. And I think you have a very interesting journey with motherhood. You are now expecting your third child. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I remember shortly when after I had moved from Minnesota, your first daughter, Yaya, was just a little bit over 1 year old when she passed away. And I wonder, when you look at your approach to motherhood, how do you take all of this in when there are, I assume, many joys with being a mother, but also some incredible heartbreaks that can also come along with it?
Mm-hmm. You know, I really appreciate that you say that I'm, you know, resilient and I have this good outlook in life, but I think it is, when I think of resilience, I was thinking about this. I feel like it's not just a personality trait, or I used to think that it's a personality trait. And then I thought, oh, maybe it's a skill set, because you have to learn how to deal with stress. You have to learn how to deal with, just the hardship of life. But then I realized that I could not have done any of that. I could not have stayed sane through our daughter's illness and the odyssey of trying to even figure out what happened and why she was sick. And then deal with her passing away and trying to, you know, move on with our family, holding her, and how to continue her legacy and her life with us in different ways. Mm-hmm. And I realized that I couldn't do it all by myself. And like you said, I'm a wife, I have a husband, I have families, and that's what kept me together. Mm-hmm. To be able to have that social network and that safety net around me to support me. Obviously, it's both ways, right? I also support my husband. I support my family. But looking from my perspective, having all the help that was available to me when we were taking care of Yaya and then dealing with the grief and, you know, dealing with all the other things in life, being able to put myself in an environment where I have my husband, who has been a wonderful partner all these years, and having his parents and his family around us to support us, giving us the help we needed, having my parents, my mom came, my parents still live in China, and my mom came three times during Yaya's life and spending months and months here to cook for us and help us, all of that. That's what makes me resilient.
Yeah, of course, of course.
And I think, you know, I recognize that not everyone has that kind of safety net, but I think it's really important to surround ourselves with people that we love and support us.
Yeah, that's so well said. June, what are some of your favorite memories with Yaya? And I also think you have a very fun picture that perhaps you'll share with us.
Let me share it now. And also give me an opportunity to clean myself up. So can you see it?
Yeah. Oh. Her first birthday party, huh?
Yes, that was her birthday party in our apartment. So Yaya, her name is Ya'el, and it means mountain goat in Hebrew. So we made her a little cake with a little goat sitting on the top of the mountain.
Oh, that's right. So cute.
Yeah, and I don't know if if you look really closely, you can see her feeding tube kind of on the right of the picture. But that was just one of the most joyful days that we had with her.
Yeah, well, she was sure what she had the tenacity of a mountain goat, for sure.
She did. What a warrior. She really was a fighter.
Yeah. What did you learn from her?
I think we learned from, we learned to love our family fiercely, and to be together and be present.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that applies to any kind of hardship, or any difficult time in life.
Yeah.
You know, to know that, and it's important to enjoy what you have.
Right. I mean, I think it's such a fine balance, because life truly hands us these really, you know, really, there's some very joyful moments that come with life. And of course, part of the human experience is, of course, the experience of contrast, right? And so the contrast of joy, of course, is sorrow and heartbreak and grief. And, you know, sometimes I think, of course, those moments are difficult, and I certainly don't ever wish them on anybody. But when they do happen, I really do feel like it helps you just even more fully experience what it means to be a human, to know that full range mm-hmm. of emotions and experiences that people can have. And I think also from those really tough moments, I think it also just builds more empathy for us as mm-hmm. we're able to relate and see the sorrows and the hardships that other people are going through, because I think in any given moment, we never know what's really going on in somebody else's life.
Right.
But when we have had those tougher moments, just speaking for myself, like, I feel like I am able to more readily identify that in others, and just to hold people a little bit more, just with a little bit more grace, a little bit more mm-hmm. levity and kindness and empathy. So.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think, you know, a couple of things that you mentioned that I really strongly agree with. One is that we can't just simply separate our work life from our family life mm-hmm. and everything outside of our, you know, work. And I think that has been especially present now, because so many people are working from home, so many people are dealing with lack of childcare, and how, like, maybe they don't have access to good, you know, to resources they need to be able to work, and our life, our work life and our family life is intertwined more so now than ever. And being able to sit back and think, how do I, you know, how do I handle all at the same time? And someone had told me that, you know, we'd always talk about work-life balance, as if you put work on one side and life on the other, but it's not always that way, right? It's all together. You just have one life. And sometimes we have to make changes to make one work better and sacrifice the other, and that line that you draw is not always going to stay where it is. It has to, you know, move around as situation changes. Right. And I think sometimes it's okay to step back a little bit in work. So when Yaya was sick, Yaya passed away when she was 13. And this picture was taken, you know, a week before we went into the hospital for the last time. And a month before she passed away. But we started to realize that something was wrong with her when she was probably 2 months old. So for about a little less than a year, we had dealt with her really rapidly progressing disease. And during that period of time, I started to cut back on my work schedule gradually. I was really grateful that my department and my firm was super supportive of that. And actually at that time, my husband worked at the same law firm, Fredrickson, with me. So they're, you know, as a firm, they're like on the brink of losing two attorneys at the same time. And they were so supportive of us and provided us a lot of flexibility in our work life. And our colleagues stepped in when we had to, you know, go into the hospital suddenly. multiple times. And we were able to really spend, you know, every hospital stay that Yaya had, both of us were able to be there and work remotely from the hospital room, which was really helpful to us. But also I recognize that was a privilege a lot of families didn't have, you know. But my point is that sometimes you just have to cut back and then come back in when you're ready.
Right.
And I think that's okay.
Absolutely. The ebb and flow following that. And I mean, as you talk about the support of your law firm, it really sounds like you had the support from all different directions during this incredibly difficult time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And the other thing that I wanted to bring to talk about as a follow-up to what you were saying, and let me change the picture. This is another picture I wanted to show you guys.
Okay.
Okay, here we go. So this picture was taken in Big Bend National Park in Texas, soon after Yaya died. Ron and I, my husband and I, we went on a road trip for a month around the country. We literally just left our apartment in Minneapolis, drove straight south on 35W in the middle of the winter. And we got, we went on our first backpacking trip together in Big Bend National Park. And that was probably the hardest backpacking trip I've ever done, because you had to climb over this gigantic mountain, this basin, climb out of it, and then hike 2 days around the outskirt of the basin, and then spend the last day climbing over the mountain again to go back into the basin. It was physically challenging. It was the first backpacking trip I did. We've done a lot of camping before, but I've never done a backpacking trip where you had to carry all your water. You didn't know if you were going to be able to make it to your campsite every night. So I was under a lot of stress the entire time. But when we were on the top of the mountain, looking out into, I think this was looking out into Mexico, actually, you see this really huge landscape of just mountains and mesas in front of you. And that just reminded us how small we are as human beings. And then the world is not just about us. You know, it really put me into perspective when we were dealing with the grief that we had, to realize that, okay, there's a lot more important things in the world. There's a lot of people out there and a lot out there that's not about us. And to know that was really important for me to realize that my sorrow is so small compared to where we are.
Well, I also think, you know, not to discount your own sorrow too. And I think, you know, these experiences, motherhood, grief, I mean, the list goes on and on. It is, it is both, I think I've heard it described as both intimate and impersonal at the same time. Intimate in the sense that it is deeply personal, it is deeply painful. And of course it is all consuming because it is, of course, your own life, but also that it is impersonal because this is an experience that many people also around the world are going through in their own variation. Mm-hmm. And so that's a really powerful picture that you have here. And I think I see a little mountain goat, which.
Yes, so that's the little wooden mountain goat. That's basically Yaya symbol for us. And if you come to our house, you'll find little sculptures of mountain goats of all sorts of materials, like scattered around our house, because we just started collecting them. But we carried her, that particular wooden mountain goat, with her, with us throughout the whole road trip. Being able to take that time off. And again, with the amazing support that our family and our firm had for us to be able to do that, and just to take ourselves out of out of that immediate loss that we had.
Right.
And being able to just change our perspective and reset, that was really important for us as well.
Right.
I love that. And
oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, and then the last thing that I wanted to bring up from our experience with the Yaya and with the really rare, what took her life was a very rare genetic disorder called 4-H leukodystrophy. So leukodystrophy itself is a rare genetic disease that basically impacts our ability to, our brain function. And for 4-H is a very small subset within leukodystrophy. And what happened was, unknown to both Ron and I, we were carriers of a mutation on the same spot in our genes, and unknown to us, Yaya inherited both mutations. So there's a specific piece of her genes that that contributes to the formation of white matters in her brain that was not functioning correctly. And that ultimately took, you know, she lost a lot of her abilities and ultimately took her life. And only a few hundred kids or people around the world have been diagnosed with this. But what I wanted to say is that because of Yaya and because of that revelation to us about this genetic disorder and our experience with, you know, dealing with the medical system, dealing with doctors who didn't know what this genetic disease was, and still trying to get her the best medical care and therapies that she could get while she was alive. That whole experience had connected us with this whole new world of rare disease community that I think we don't know about. We didn't know about. And our experience really opened our eyes to a whole world. And we are now, my husband is the driving force behind this, but we co-founded a foundation. We connected with all the other 4-H families, and we're trying to really and connected with all the researchers and clinicians who are in this field. And we are now trying through the foundation to build a research structure that will speed up the research to find a cure or, you know, effective therapies for people with 4-H leukodystrophy. And also, in the meantime, support families who are struggling through the same thing that we did before. So all of that we're doing outside of our, you know, lawyering work. My husband is a lawyer too. Right. But that experience has been really rewarding to us as well. And also, you know, from a legal career standpoint, maybe it's not a direct extension to our legal career, but it also enriched our life a lot and connected us to so many more people that we otherwise wouldn't have been connected to.
Yeah, and I think that says so much about you and Ron, that, you know, from such a massive tragedy in your own personal lives, you are able to emerge from the ashes with foundation and this new community and really being at the forefront of all the cutting edge medical research and forwarding this so that, you know, Yaya has this legacy of being part of this movement from the very, very beginning. So congratulations on this.
Thank you.
Is there a website for the foundation that we could visit?
Yes. It is the Yaya Foundation 4HL.org.
Got it.
And we're constantly working on developing the website, making it better. But I invite every one of you guys to visit.
Absolutely. Well, June, you know, really, I think what's so remarkable about your story is that it's such a powerful reminder of how multifaceted our lives are. It is not all about just work. Life happens. Life sometimes hands you a couple unexpected curveballs, sometimes some curveballs we really would prefer not to have. So we are always at choice in terms of how we respond to these curveballs when they do show up. We get to choose mm-hmm. our thoughts, which of course informs our feelings and affects the actions that we then take. And so that you now have, I mean, and now you have baby number three on the way. So how exciting as well. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
June, is there anything? Oh, go ahead.
Oh, as soon as I really agree with you when you talk about the curveballs in life. I almost feel like, you know, there are people who have has a very specific vision of what their career is going to be, what their career path is going to be, and what their life is going to be as different age where I'm going to accomplish different things. I was not one of those people. And I think a lot of us are not as clear as to what we want to do with our life, or, you know, at different parts, at times in life. And I think it is important to recognize that life can change and our pathway can change. You know, a single event can change how we deal with things. The pandemic can change how our life and our work can be. I think it's important to take what life throws at us and try to make the best out of it.
Beautifully said. June, is there anything else you'd like to share with our audience today?
I'm very grateful that you invited me to, get on this podcast. And thank you very much. And you know, I think I don't see myself as someone who is like successful or has accomplished, you know, what I want to accomplish in life. That's probably the immigrant and the, you know, especially the stereotype Asian immigrant in me. But I do think that I try to live life fully and to, and I want to say that with that, I have been able to surround myself with people I love and the family I love and work family that I love. And that's what I find meaning in.
Yeah.
I don't think that being a lawyer is a particularly glamorous or particularly joyful career path. And I can certainly see a lot of people, you know, think that it would be before they get into this career. But I think what's important is really to find a practice area that you feel passionate about, you feel meaning in, and get the most out of it.
Yeah, and right, exactly. And to find that, you know, ideally, if you are able to find that in your work, your professional life, great. If not, there are also all these other different ways that we can live a very full and very present and very meaningful life outside of work. Work is simply just one fraction of our lives.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Well, I'm so grateful for you today and always. Your friendship, June, has meant the world to me. So thank you for joining me today.
Thank you. Likewise. That feeling is neutral.
Yeah. How can people connect with you if they would like to ask you any questions or just generally connect?
Yeah, I can be contacted on LinkedIn. Like Andrea said, I'm expecting my third child any day now. So please forgive me if I don't respond right away, but I do would love to connect with many of you if you would like to.
That's so kind.
Yeah, feel free to.
That's so, so generous. Thank you, June. I am wishing you all the best for a smooth delivery. I would love to see pictures.
Thank you. Yeah, I will bombard you with all the newborn pictures.
I can't wait. Great. Well, we're going to call it a wrap for today. Thank you so much for joining us. If you've enjoyed this conversation with June, make sure you hit like and subscribe for future videos. I would also love to hear what you learned today from this conversation. You can write me through my website or you can leave a comment below. See you next time.